Welcome to the series where we're going to take you on a journey to be more self-sufficient.
What more do you want?
As I'm going to rekindle our passion for easy-to-follow DIY.
Perfect.
We'll be looking back at the TV archives to rediscover the very best homes and gardens advice.
Aerate the soil of the area that you're going to re-turf.
From some of the nation's favourite experts.
The potatoes in the ground have been very successful.
Showing you how, even with limited tools...
Who's first for the sausages, then?
..we can all master the basic skills. Now, that is solid. Everything from upcycling...
We're going to have fun.
..quick fixes...
You see how easy it comes off?
..right through to the builds that we all need to know.
There's really not a lot to it.
Plus, in my workshop, I'll be sharing my simple home hacks.
It works a treat.
And demos to get everybody started. If you can pinch an inch, you've done it too loose. Inspiring you to do it all yourself, saving you money, and finally tackling those everyday jobs together. Job done and dusted. Welcome to the last show. Don't worry, we've got a jam-packed episode for you. It's got tricks, hacks, and makes showing you how to be more self-sufficient, and in next to no time, I think you're going to be an expert. So grab a notebook and let's get started. Today, we've got some top tips on how you can revitalise your grass.
If you cultivate your lawn, you can get your grass to be good and thick and strong.
We learn loads of upcycling ideas from turning an old sofa into a brand new bench.
It just gives a nice texture to the wood.
To firm favourite Sarah, transforming an old ladder into something completely different.
Have a back across there. Plants in there.
As well as how you can make your own Georgian-style shutter from scratch.
Made out of MDF, because Georgians were big on the old MDF in them days.
Plus, I'll be showing you how to build your very own sideboard. And I do need my 90-degree clamps. Now, while the sun is shining, there's one place that can really suffer from the heat, and that's your lawn. Well, not to worry, Toby's here to show us some essential guides on looking after your grass.
Yes, all the usual suspects are here. Leaves left on the grass too long, so worm casts come to the surface. There's bare patches and there's moss and clover outcompeting the grass. But if you cultivate your lawn, this is what all lawn lovers know, you can get your grass to be good and thick and strong. And now's the time to do it. But you don't make cakes without breaking eggs. And this isn't going to look great when I've finished, but in the medium term, it's going to come back to life and be a really hard-wearing, good-looking lawn.
Move any family pets, as the lawn feed we're going to apply later could harm them. Keep them off the grass until the feed has disappeared into the soil. Make sure the blade on your mower is sharp.
Now, here's why you should get your lawnmower serviced every year. If it's got a blunt blade, it will leave the tips of your grass ragged, bruised, and vulnerable to disease.
Next, scarify. With a spring-tined rake, work the whole lawn lengthways and widthways. You'll be amazed how much dead material, known as thatch, you gather up. This stuff can stop water and fertiliser reaching the soil. Clearing it also lets the grass breathe and encourages side shoots to grow.
Now, this moss, it just loves what grass hates. Compacted, moist, nutrient-poor soil. And that's why there's so much of it here.
There are loads of weed killers on the market that target moss, but they will only treat the symptoms, not the cause. The best way to eliminate it is by aeration. But first, give the lawn yet another mow to suck up the last of the thatch. Now you can aerate it. Spike the lawn every 10 centimetres with a fork. This will improve drainage and get air and nutrients to the roots. Lots of people never feed their lawns, but if you want it to look good, then apply a lawn food 4 times a year.
Now, the key thing at this time of year is to avoid nitrogen, because that just encourages soft, leafy growth that will be damaged by winter cold. Instead, you major on phosphates and potassium, two nutrients that encourage robust growth and healthy roots.
If your you're serious about looking after your grass, then it's worth investing in a drop spreader. They cost around £30 and guarantee a measured dose. It's quicker too. Water in, then reseed any areas that are looking thin. Finally, rake in the seed.
We'll take your word on that, Toby. Now, the best time to sow your grass seeds is between late summer and mid-autumn, or mid-spring. Now, make sure you pick the best or the peak time to give your grass the best shot it needs. And a classic problem is birds eating your seeds. Now, you've got two options there. You can either get some fruit netting and lay it across the top, or just put 50% more. Because the birds have got to eat as well, haven't they? Old sofas could be rife with problems. It could be the springs, it could be the fabric, or even the frame. Yeah, not good. But we've got Josh and Ollie show us exactly what they do with an old sofa to bring it right up to date to be a modern bench. You've got to see this one.
I've never done anything like this before. Yeah, once we've worked out how the slats are going to go across, and probably once we've worked out what we're going to do with the legs, I think that they're really the two most difficult parts. The rest of it should be all right.
The sofa frame was constructed using the traditional mortise and tenon method, a technique which has been used for thousands of years. But the mortise holes and tenon tongues are badly damaged.
It's all feeling a little bit rickety, so we've just got to try and work out the best way of getting it back to a state where you can sit on it again.
The only option is to repair the joints. The traditional craftsmanship they use to mend the joints is second to none.
It's nice when you get to the end of it and it's kind of looking fresh again, and you've just got like a nice match and a nice fill in there. So then we can put the tenon back in and glue it just as it was. It should be as strong as it was brand new then.
When the repaired tenon is slotted back into the mended mortise, it's a perfect fit. The lads use strap clamps to hold the sofa in position while the glue dries. But it's back to business, and there's some blowtorching to be done. A charred finish is a difficult technique to master, but if they get it right, it will give the sofa a striking look.
It just gives a nice, like, texture to the wood. It also preserves the wood as well. It's like a natural way of doing that. It just brings it back to a nice, even, matte black finish.
The lads are taking safety precautions against fumes released from the old wood stain. Fingers crossed, this gives the sofa the sleek and stylish look they're after. If they get this wrong, it could warp the wood. It was beat up and broken down. Wow, it's been born again like a phoenix from the flames. The scorched wood has been sanded down to create a smooth, matte black finish. This contrasts beautifully with the light American maple timber used for the seat. Craftsmanship on display here is second to none.
Wow, now that was a transformation. For the beginners amongst us, if you're dealing with wood furniture, all you have to do is give it a rub down and a paint, and that will give it a new lease of life. But if it was me, I've definitely got Atom upholstery in there because I like a bit of comfort. And remember, these boys are experts, so don't go blowtorching any furniture unless you've got a professional beside you. Now, a brand new sideboard can cost a fortune, but I'm going to show you how to make one at a fraction of the price. I've got some pine board here, really simple to buy. Just go to your local timber yard. I need a top and a bottom, and then I need the sides, and then all the little bits that go inside of it. So the sides are touching, they're absolutely perfect. If you look here, this one sticks out a bit, that one's sticking out, they're not straight. So what you've got to do is cut a straight edge. Now, if you are going to use any form of heavy machinery, make sure you follow all of the safety guidelines. So with this one, I need goggle and I need a dust mask. And I'm going to need an extractor because there's going to be a lot of wood chippings coming out of here. So now I've got a straight edge. I can measure the size that I need, the top and the bottom, and it's going to be 152 centimetres. Right. And I'm going to clamp it down, and then I'm going to cut it. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to set my saw so it doesn't cut my bench. So now I've got the top and the bottom done. I just need the sides. I'm going to make the height of the sides 43 centimetres. So I'll mark there. So now I'm going to put it together, and I do need my 90-degree clamps. If you do have someone that can help you do this, it'll be advisable. So then what I'm going to do is I'm going to pre-drill some holes there to then secure this to that. So that is in there solid. So all I've got to do is repeat the same process on the other side, and then we have sort of a box. Just got to put the top on, or the bottom, whichever way you look at it. Now you've got your box, what you want to try and create is some dividers in here. So, measure inside here, and I've already pre-cut one. And that will be a divider. And I've done exactly the same with the door. I've pre-cut a door, and I've done it to the outer lip. The door shuts like that, and then bring this up so it marries up to the door. Because I want to secure this piece, and the way that I could do that is just put a ruler down. Make sure it's nice and straight, and I could measure from there, and that gives me a measurement of 92 centimetres. So I know at 92 centimetres, that's where this timber lies, so it sits, and I can just start drilling a little bit in the middle there. And you can draw a nice little faint line, because you can always rub these lines out after. So, I can move on to doing this bit. So I've cut a bit of timber to that size, which is 43 centimetres. And then what I've done is I've measured up to where I want the shelf to be. And I've done that at 21 centimetres. So as that is not secure, what you're going to need is one of these little babies. It's really, really useful because this will tell me if it's level. And if it's level, you can drill away. Now we've got it all together, I'm just going to sort the door out. And basically, I don't want to have a handle, and I've got this little thing, which is magnetic, and this goes inside where the door is. And as soon as you push it, it opens the door up. So now all that's left to do is turn it upside down, put the legs on, and drill the back in. Whenever you're putting the legs on, make sure you've got an equal distance all around. So they've got to be the same. That's the best way to do it. So now that's the back on, all I've got to do is turn it around the right way and you've got a sideboard. Simple as that. I'm pretty chuffed with that. Now, you can really make this your own. You can add some paint, you can add wallpaper, even fabric. And if you're feeling confident, why not knock up a couple of coffee tables just to match the sideboard? Go on, give it a go. Now, windows aren't always the easiest things to spruce up without spending a bit of cash. But you're about to see, as we step back a few years, a great way to give your windows a new look by making some homemade Georgian-style shutters.
OK, I'm just measuring up now for these Georgian shutters that Hazel wants, and I've just found out that they're maybe getting these windows here replaced with PVC windows. Usually what I would do is hinge them off the side of the jamb here, and that would be job done, but unfortunately, because we don't know what they're going to be keeping here, I'm going to be running a 2x1 batten, which I'm going to plug and screw to the wall, and we're going to hinge the shutters off them. As you've guessed, the shutters themselves are going to be made out of MDF. OK, here we have the shutter. So what I've done so far is, first of all, I've cut out the panel here. Then what I've done is routed out the edge here just to accept this 6mm piece of MDF. As you can see, there you have it, the old traditional Georgian shutter made out of MDF, because the old Georgians were big on the old MDF in them days. All we've got to do now is glue it together, put it on the wall, job's done. Okay, just finishing off the first shutter here. What I've used is 2-inch flush hinges, which basically means that you can just fix them straight on to both sides of the timber. You don't have to mess about with housing out with chisels and all that. It's just a nice easy job. Fix them straight in, its job's done. I've used that on both on the jamb, plus to hinge the two shutters together. And as you can see, the advantage of having them as a bifolding shutter is that you get a panel effect both sides. Right, now that one's done. Just got three more to do.
Even though that was from 20 years ago, that style is still popular. Now, if you don't want to use MDF, you could use plywood, which has a grain, and you could stain it rather than paint it. When it comes to DIY, there's one item that we all need, but we probably don't give it much thought. What is it? It's a ladder. Now, when you're buying one, there's loads to consider, and there's loads of options out there. So have a look at this, it might help you.
So if you're going out to buy a ladder, what do you need to look for? Well, let's start in the bottom rung. This is the ideal sort of thing to have around a kitchen if you've got out of reach cupboards. What you want to look for in this type of stool is that it's of an all-steel construction, which is a bit more expensive, but it's a lot more stable than an aluminium one. You want to look for rubber anti-slip treads and anti-slip feet. And a particular feature of this step stool is it's extra wide, which means an elderly person who's a bit tired can sit down. Moving on to step ladders, you'll find quite a variety on the market, but basically this can be broken down into two different categories: lightweight and heavy-duty aluminium step ladders. These lightweight ones would be ideal for occasional DIY use around the house. But why not spend about 50% more and get these heavy-duty ones? Features you're likely to find in these are twin rails down the front, which support heavier treads. You've got strapping to stop the ladder overextending. And at the back here, you've got extra aluminium struts, which makes the whole thing stronger. You're also likely to find a larger platform area, which means you're going to feel more stable. And a particular feature of this ladder is the distance from the platform here to the handrail is greater. Now, what does that mean? Let me show you. When I go up this ladder, the distance from the platform to the handrail isn't that great. So it supports me just below the knees, and that means I don't feel that stable. On the other hand, when I go up the heavy ladder, I find the distance is a lot greater. That means that I'm supported above the knees and it feels a lot safer. Moving on to extension ladders, there's quite a variety of different types on the market. But this can be broken down into three main categories: Class 3 domestic, Class 2 light trade, and Class 1 industrial. This is a Class 3 domestic ladder. It has two sections of 2.5 metres. That means when extended, it gives you a working height of 4 metres. Class 2 extension ladders, whilst also being suitable for domestic use, are aimed at light trade work, such as decorating, window cleaning, and general maintenance. They're a lot more expensive than a Class 3 ladder, but they're significantly stronger and much more stable. Whilst both of these ladders extend to well over 6 metres, this one's in 2 sections and this one's in 3 sections. That means when it's stored away, it'll take up less room, but bear in mind it'll cost you about 25% more. One final thing about extension ladders: no matter what height you're working at, you should always have someone holding them at the bottom.
It's vital to pick the right ladder for the right job. They all have their different benefits. And later, we'll be seeing more ladders as the queen of upcycling turns an old one into something completely different. Now, we all own tools, but if not organised, they can be hard to find. Now, we're all guilty of just throwing them into a toolbox. Not good, but I've got just the thing for you. Things that you need is your measuring tape, your drill, some clamps, pencil, some plastic pipe, a little button, and a saw. So whenever I'm cutting these, what I found is I like to roll. So what I normally do is make kind of like a little grip or a little jig to hold them in. So just make sure it's flush. And then I get the pipe I want in there, and then get the other one and make sure it's really nice and tight. Then you've got to drill it down into the bench. Now, I wouldn't recommend doing this in your kitchen table. That is secure. It's not going anywhere, but I could pull it out. So I'm measuring these at about 30 centimetres, and that's where I'm going to cut it. I've got these clamps. Now, I've got a wood saw, and I'm using it on plastic, and it goes through it like it's butter. Just needs a good rub down. Sandpaper. So we're going to need a few of those. So here, I pre-cut some already. And I've got just an off-cut of a piece of tine, actually. I've got my 2 sides. Now, I normally use the 90-degree clamps, but on this little thing, I can hold it together. And as long as I'm pushing downwards into the bench, then it should hold itself. I'm just going to preset a couple of screws in here. So then I can just hold it without holding the screw at the same time. Make sure that's all nice and flush, and then drill away. I'm just going to repeat the process on the other side. So now this is starting to take shape. So I need to fix the base on. And then all I've got to do, just got to make one cut. So I'm going to make my mark underneath. Now I'm going to cut it. And there you have it. Now you could decorate this however you want. And all it needs now is some tools. So we've got a tool tidy. It's practical, useful, and you've made it yourself. Now that's easy to make and practical. And it doesn't just have to be for tools. It could be for kitchen utensils or paintbrushes or anything you fancy. Still to come, Sarah's going to be showing you a great way of upcycling an old wooden ladder into something completely different.
Lovely little planters out of each of the steps.
And I'm going to show you how to build your very own radiator cover, which is as easy as pie. We want the heat to hit the top and then just to shoot out. When it comes to decking, all it takes is a few bad winters without treatment, then it is ruined beyond repair. If you have a bit of time on your hands, why not replace it while the sun is shining? It's going to save you a packet, and it will take you one more step to being self-sufficient. Well, here's AJ to show us how to do it.
As you can see, it's rotten to death, really, by wood. And the biggest problem is, I think, is here. As you can see, it's just soil.
soil holds water. The water then has been sitting against this timber. Even though it's treated, it shortens the life. So we're going to do something to prepare the new joist timbers to stop that happening. Fingers crossed.
Yes, that really has had it. Good luck, AJ. You've got your work cut out all right.
To be honest, this looks safer as it is now. Much safer. Got a bit of plastic sheeting here, which I'm just going to staple to the side of this decking frame. So it then keeps the sodden soil away from the wood. I can't go all the way around the wood because that would make it sweat and would have the same problem then with obviously getting damp and then getting rotten.
Now AJ's ready to give his frame some legs.
I'm just putting in the posts now to raise up the framework so it doesn't sit on any soil or puddles of water once the rain comes in. Very simple, dig a hole, get the post in, screw it to the joist. The more the merrier. The best bit of this, putting the decking boards down. Cut them to size, all the same length so it looks pretty. As I start screwing them down, I'm leaving sort of a 5mm gap. One for the expansion or the contraction of the wood when it's hot or cold and wet. And also when the rain does go on here, even though it has got the runs in it for rain to go off, you want the rain to drip down the sides and dissipate underneath. If they're really close together, water's got nowhere to go, and once again, we'd have the same problem of water sitting on it. It soaks it up and eventually rots a lot quicker.
AJ, how are we doing, mate?
Not bad.
You nearly finished?
Anyway, I've got one more piece to put in on the decking here. Still got to replace those. Still got to build the arbour.
Okay.
So, you know, 20 minutes and...
You're quite confident that you'll get this done in 20
minutes?
I'm
never confident.
You're never confident?
No.
This once loved space had become shabby and inaccessible. But in just one day and with a small budget, Danny has transformed it into a bright and beautiful haven of peace and productivity. Repairing the rickety decking with brand new boards has made the garden accessible.
Some great tips there on keeping your decking from rotting for as long as possible. There's some great options on the market at the moment. There's some eco-friendly composite decking that is low maintenance. That's the one I would buy. Another way to refresh your deck is to give it a really good clean with some specialist cleaning products. And what that's going to do is bring that lovely wood colour back to life. I always go on about upcycling, because if you're going to chuck it out anyway, what have you got to lose trying to turn it into something new? Sarah's back again to give us all an easy lesson on how you could take something like an old ladder and turn it into something super useful.
I love these ladders, but I want to make lovely little planters out of each of the steps. Fill them up with beautiful bulbs, and so people can have them in their homes, out on their windowsill, by the front door, just bringing a little bit of colour in their life, and then using all this lovely white paint, flaky surface, as a real selling point. How hard can that be? Let's make a plan. When you do something, measure twice, cut once.
Not a complete novice, then.
Look away now.
Oh, spoke too soon. A good start would be to secure the ladder by clamping it down. Let the saw do the work. The longer the stroke, the easier it will be. We could be here for a while.
Have a back across there. Plants in there. I'm channeling potting shed chic. It's going to be awesome. Just want to make sure I can make one. And I'm on the right track before I cut the whole thing up and have to make a plan.
Sarah's putting the final touches to her refashioned planters.
It's coming along, isn't it? Not quite there, though. I want it to really pack a punch.
It needs wow factor, sparkle, pizzazz. or an old tin bucket. Not exactly what I had in mind.
Happy days.
Happy days indeed. The steps of the ladder now make up 7 country cottage planters. Sarah kept costs down by using soil from her own molehills and bulbs from a car boot sale. And as much as it pains me to admit, the tin bucket tags are an inspired addition.
Love that. And it was so easy. It costs virtually nothing. And there's loads you can do with an old ladder. From hanging it up to making it into a clothes dryer, you can make shelves out of it, you can even turn part of it into a tea towel rack for your kitchen. Just get creative. When it comes to covering up radiators, it's all down to personal preference. Some people like to have them on show, and some people like to hide them. Well, don't worry. I'm going to show you how to make your very own radiator cover. It's a really simple construction. This is the grill in the front. It's made out of MDF, and it has 2 sides. That's the back side, and that's the front. I've had the MDF cut, and I'm using an 18mm MDF here because this is quite solid and it gives a firm base. What we're gonna do is we're gonna have 1 inch like that. And then, not that like that. We're gonna attach this border to there, and I have this handy little jig. And what it does is if you clamp there, you drill in, it gives a nice slope, a nice angle for the screw to go in and hold those 2 tight together. If you don't have one of these, or you can't find one of them, you can always use an L-shaped bracket, and that would attach underneath, work like that. So I want this to come off the floor, so 10 centimetres from the base, because most radiators don't go right down to the floor. So I'm gonna make my mark on there so I know exactly where I want that to be. And I'm gonna do the same on the other side. And then I clamp this in place. And then it comes with a drill bit. And then this bit, you can just adjust this little guide and put it to exactly where you want it, and that's it, it will stop. What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna put that in there like that and just start to drill. In here now, I've got a groove where the screw will go in, it'll come out that end and attach itself to that bit there. So before I do that, I'm gonna drill the other one and then you'll see both of them in action. So now I've got those 2 done, I'm then gonna go over to this side and do the same thing again. So now I've got these pre-drilled, put it up to where my mark is, get a screw, drill it in. And I would recommend if you're doing it this way, put a sliver of glue just in there to make sure they hold nice and secure. Same thing again. And that is nice and secure. And then now, do the same on this side. So now, with this one, I'm gonna do exactly the same thing. Now that's pre-drilled, I'm gonna turn this around so I can work on this bit. So we left a gap of 10 centimetres down there. And this one is not gonna be so big because we want the heat to hit the top and then just to shoot out. So I'd make this one at least 5. Because the more concentrated you can actually have the heat coming out, the better this cover would be working. So that is nice and secure. Then, when you're putting this in, try and get it even. Now you can either glue this down, or I've got a staple gun, so I'm just gonna staple these into there. Now this is the top. What I'm then gonna do is attach the other leg. So this is the bit that will be going against the wall. We've got to make sure top and the bottom are both flush because one's going to be sitting on the floor, the other one's going to have the top on it. You don't want it a little bit offset. So I've got these little 90-degree clamps just for holding this in place while I get the couple of screws or pre-drill into there. Once I've got a screw in place, don't need to hold it anymore. That's one side done. Just going to repeat the process on this side. Now we've got the sides on and we've got the panel in, let's flip it up, see how it looks. Right, so now all we've got to do is put the top on, so a little mantelpiece, I'm going to cut that to size, and then that should be it, done and dusted. But you can paint this the colour that you want it. This has got white already on there. If you didn't want it to be white, put a primer on and seal it. But don't forget, on this side here, or that side as well, you're going to have to cut out part for your skirting board or your pipes. And then put the lid on there. I'm going to allow a little bit of a hangover. I'm going to put this on the floor, put the top on, and see how it looks. So, imagine you've got the radiator behind here. The heat hits the top of this shelf, and then it's going to come out, and it's going to go straight into your room. You've made a radiator cover. Enjoy it. Now, there you go. You've even got the top as a mantelpiece. Now, that's a bonus. I got my MDF pre-cut, but if you intend on cutting it yourself, make sure you're wearing goggles and a mask. Now, there's one thing that hasn't gone out of fashion in the home, and that's carpet. Now, fitting one yourself might sound like a big job, but here's Russell showing us how to do it yourself, and that is music to my ears.
No, I'm sorry, I'm just not happy with the acoustics in this room at all. It needs a carpet. As we're putting down Hessian back carpet, we need to secure it to the floor using this stuff. It's real clever stuff. It's called gripper rod, and you'll see exactly why. You can see these little sharp nails pointing up at a slight angle away that way, which we're going to put towards the wall. And you have to put this side here towards the wall. This little chamfered bit here has a very important part to play, because what's going to happen is the carpet's going to be pulled taut across the top of those little nails, tucked round the back, and then released, and they'll grip it in place. That's the theory. One other thing you need to think about is there are different gripper rods for different applications. Now, this is a wooden floor, so these nails here that I'm going to drive into the floor are serrated, whereas the gripper rod you'll need for concrete isn't. Now, I'm going to space the gripper rod away from the wall using a little bit of offcut here that I've removed the nails from, and that's the precise distance you need, around about a quarter of an inch away from the skirting board. Now, this stuff here is absolutely essential, because without underlay, your carpet is going to wear out really, really quickly. But make sure the foam or the rubber is facing down towards the floor. Okay, got lots of this to go down. Standard thicknesses means two runs of underlay. Make sure that you're using a nice sharp knife or a pair of scissors, and that'll make the job nice and easy for you. What you need to do is make sure that your knife is in nice and tight to the gripper rod at about 45 degrees, and then when you lay the carpet, there's not going to be a gap here for the carpet to drop down into. This is a clever bit of kit. It's called a hand stapler. You can staple down the underlay, or you can use tacks. You can hire these things or buy one if you want to spend about 25 quid. And you need to do it all the way down the center, wherever there's a join, around about every half a meter, and in the four corners of the room. Well, I'm all tooled up and ready to go. I've laid the carpet out loosely, mainly just to make sure that we've got the right size, because it would be a nightmare if we hadn't. And as you'll notice up this end here, I haven't got any excess of carpet. It's all down that way. And that's because it's much easier to work away from a radiator than up to it. Now, this thing here is called a stretcher, and you really will be lost without it. So beg, steal, or borrow one of those. And the idea is simply, you give it a little kick like that with your knee to make sure you've got enough here to tuck down into the gap that we've left between the gripper rod and the skirting board. And the way you tuck it down is with one of these. It's a bolster, and just bash it in there so it catches behind that little beveled edge I showed you earlier. Look at that, pipe, carpet, no join. Isn't that great? It's really simple. The key here is a nice sharp knife. Sharp is really the operative word. Let's just show you how we did that. Just cut them down here, nice and gently, not too far, so it neatly fits round. Then what we're going to do is diagonal cut there, and a diagonal cut on this side here too, like that there, and then it all just fits in nice and neatly all the way around. Just watch this. Here we go. Push that in there like that. Push that in there like that. Wonderful job. An inch away on top of the grip rods, a couple of hard kicks, one and two. And now take your bolster and just make doubly sure the carpet is actually being caught by the little pins in the grip rod. There's now tension in this carpet, so I need to cut off the excess down this side here. There is now a tool on the market that speeds the whole process up. It's this thing here. It's called a carpet trimmer, and watch how it works. As long as you obey one basic rule, and that is you have to stay opposite the carpet trimmer at all times, you won't go wrong. This is the fourth and final wall, the most important one of all. Need to get some tension in here. So this tension device is on top of the grip rods underneath, and bang, bang, a couple of hard hits, and you can feel it gripping already. I'm going to do this all the way down to the end and then trim it off. What I'm trying to do here is keep not only the tension on my knee, but also some pressure on the end of the stretcher here. And away we go with the bolster. Perfect. It's amazing what difference a little bit of carpet makes, isn't it? And I have someone that actually appreciates my music here as well. Hello.
Yes, it really was that easy. And pretty much the methods they used back then, it's the same ones they're using today. Now, there are all different types of carpets and there's all different types of floors. So check out which one you need before you start doing the job. Remember, fitting carpet is hard on the knees and the pins in the grippers, they're really, really sharp. So make sure you wear knee pads and gloves. You need to protect yourself. If you're unsure about anything you've seen in the show today, then speak to a professional. And if you're going to do anything structural, make sure you have a chat with your local council. Well, that's the end of the series. I hope you've enjoyed it and you've taken on loads of ideas and tricks and tips on how to get more self-sufficient. Remember, it's all about creativity, so give it a go. Happy home fixing, and I'll see you next time. Take care.